Welcome to Team Pegine's CD message. Pegine Echevarria is founder of Team Pegine, a multifaceted human potential company that focuses on leadership, success, and team building. Listen as she shares her thoughts on how to mastermind your way to success.
Hi, this is Pegine Echevarria, and I am so excited to be here with you today to talk to you about masterminds. I've used masterminds for years, and it's one of the most powerful ways that you and I and, well, anybody can actually propel your success to the highest levels at that moment in your life. I think that one of the things that's important at this time, at this juncture in both your life and my life, is the realization that we can't do this alone. We need each other to actually achieve and propel ourselves to the levels of success we dream of. So, what is a mastermind? A mastermind group can be an informal and ad hoc gathering, a regular weekly meeting, or even a monthly, or even a quarterly if that's what you need. But it has to have two or more people working together in harmony for the attainment of a definite purpose. Napoleon Hill, who wrote Think and Grow Rich, described it as this: it's a coordination of knowledge and effort in a spirit of harmony between two or more people for the attainment of a definite purpose. A mastermind group is a support team that meets on a regular basis to provide and receive feedback and ideas. One of my first groups was when I was actually a young woman, and we call them pods, and we met, there were about seven of us, and we would work together. We worked steadily for about a year and a half. The results in our lives were truly amazing at that time when you think about 19 and 20 year olds sitting together, working and being focused on some goals. We all achieved the things that we were dreaming of at that moment for ourselves: running businesses, going back to school for our degrees, finding love. It was a powerful group of young women, and since then I've been involved in groups, well, my whole life. Mastermind groups can be powerful, but you have to follow the guidelines and the concepts of a mastermind group, and I'll be talking about that throughout this mastermind CD. This is for you so that you can create a mastermind that truly is empowering and helps you succeed. Before we begin, we need to be clear about the benefits of a mastermind group. Some of these benefits include that your mastermind provides you with a group of advisors who bring you the ability to see opportunities that you yourself may not see. Sometimes it's easier for us to see it in others than it is for ourselves. The mastermind group becomes a support group that'll keep you focused on your goals and, most importantly, hold you accountable for those goals. The mastermind group enables you to validate your own growth by pointing out where you came from and what you have achieved. You know those days when you get kind of stuck in the blahs? You show up at a mastermind group and you see for each one of those people what they've been able to do over the last month, over the last week, how they have moved and taken a step forward. The same happens for you. They see things in you that you've achieved that you may not even be aware of. You and they become part of a very productive and focused team whose vision is that all members must succeed through their trials and tribulations. This is an all-for-one and one-for-all system. It's together that you actually achieve. You know that saying, two heads are better than one? Here, you get to have quite a few heads together working on your goals as you help them work on theirs. By being a part of a mastermind, you move forward and beyond your goals and expectations. Why? Well, because as humans, we often limit ourselves by our beliefs and the barriers that we create. The mastermind team moves us past our barriers. You know, we often stop ourselves just when we're about to achieve. Or we end up putting ourselves down, avoiding what we can do because we think that we can't. By having our mastermind, it's kind of like someone putting pulling us along and saying, "What are you talking about? You have all of these great qualities. You can and you will achieve your goals." Well, now that you know the benefits, are you ready to create your own mastermind? Determining the purpose of the group. All groups work better and get results quicker if they're clear about the group's overall purpose and if individual members are able to state their own definite major purpose. Andrew Carnegie, who was one of Napoleon Hill's mentors, said this is one of the most important factors for success. In creating a mastermind, it is critical that you know why you're creating this. Why would you spend the time, the effort, the planning to create a mastermind if it's only because I said to create it? What's critically important about a mastermind group is knowing why you're together. Why bring this group of people together for what end? For some people, it's about building themselves spiritually, so they create mastermind groups together to help them reach a spiritual level. For others, it's a business group that's created so that as individual sole proprietors, they move their businesses to a whole nother level. Often, it's a group of managers who are meeting from different industries who want to be able to build their skills as leaders, as team builders, and really learn from each other and help each other move to those next levels. There are groups of moms who meet as a mastermind group because they want to make sure that their parenting skills and that they themselves are growing, so they create a mastermind group that enables them to move to the next level of parenthood. It is critical that you know why you're there so that there's no confusion. I've been involved with groups when we didn't do that, and what's happened is that, well, one person is really interested in just building themselves spiritually, while another person is interested in building their business up. It gets confusing and conflicting. Although we are there to support each other, eventually the team and the mastermind group dissipates and breaks apart because there isn't a full group purpose. There isn't a real concrete reason for being together. Some of the groups that I've been in have been about creating products or writing books so that together we're formulating a group that kind of keeps our nose to the grindstone. There'll be a variety of different masterminds in your life if you decide to go for the mastermind route. But each group is different, and each group has a definite purpose that you, especially if you're the one that's seeking and creating it, need to know. So, how do you go about doing that? Well, you need to ask yourself the following questions before you begin the process of creating a mastermind group. First, what is the purpose of the group? Is it to benefit one individual? Or is it about a mutual benefit and growing relationships on an ongoing basis? Both are legitimate. In that case, when it's about the individual alone, the mastermind group is really like a board of advisors that have decided to come together to help this person achieve their goals. Usually it's a short-term basis. Or if it's a board of advisors for a company, it can be long-term. In terms of the purpose, which we talked about earlier, was about, is it spiritual, is it for family, is it for parenting? You also need to look at, what about it do you want to share? Is it something that should only be gender specific? Is it some ways, is the purpose of the group for a community? You need to look at what the purpose is so that, as we go through the other concepts, we can specifically define how to go about reaching the people that are important to becoming a part of this group. Purpose is the first step to creating a mission. Of course, you can't create a mission if you don't have people. So, number two of the concepts is you'll need to enroll other people in your vision of success. How to enroll other people in your vision of success? This is a topic that can cover a whole nother 2 CDs, but let me give you a small overview about it. One of the critical components of a mastermind is having dedicated people who are willing to commit and participate in meetings to achieve success. It begins with you acknowledging that you can't do it alone. Success is not a solo act. To get from here to there, you'll need other people. Those people need to be committed to your success and to theirs. As we go through the list, you'll define some of the characteristics that will identify the qualities of the ideal people for your mastermind. That's one of the first steps in enrolling other people, is knowing who do you want. Your group will be a reflection of where you want to be and where you want to go, and sometimes they reflect the fears and insecurities you have. Sometimes it's just easier to keep on where we were rather than changing. And in order for the mastermind to really be proactive, in order for really, really to push you to a whole nother level, you're going to need to involve people that maybe you don't usually associate with. You see, we do tend to hang around people who make us comfortable. This is the time to find people who can make you feel uncomfortable for your own good. I'm not talking about negative people. I'm talking about people that maybe are doing things a little bit differently than you and having success with that, and getting over your own fears and your own insecurities about asking them to be part of your mastermind or their mastermind. You want to find people who are good at what you're not good at, people who you can learn from and who can learn from you. You can begin to figure out what kinds of people you want to reach out for your mastermind by asking yourself some questions. Here is how you can begin to identify the people you want to have in your mastermind group. The first, of course, is to review your purpose. Why are you here? And then define the kind of people that would be there with you. The next thing you need to do is list your own strengths and weaknesses. What are you really good at? What has made your business, your life, your parenting, your family, your spirituality move in a direction of success? What strengths do you bring to the table? Also, what are the things, your weaknesses, those things that tend to hold you back? What are they, and what would you love to learn from someone who is good at it? And what kind of person is that? You want to identify the qualities you want to have in the other participants, listing their strengths and their weaknesses. What can you help people with? So what would they be weak in? What can you seek in others that you want in yourself? Maybe it's humor. Maybe it's that you just want someone who's always giving, because maybe you're sometimes a little bit selfish. Identify those qualities. And then the third part, or fourth part, I've lost count, is to begin a list of groups and friends and associates who may know people who have an interest in being part of a mastermind. List those people who you know that are involved in a lot of organizations, and attend meetings that you don't normally go to, so you could see other people, learn from them, and maybe connect with people that might be a good fit for your mastermind. But don't ask them yet. Just get to know them. You need to go through the rest of the CD so you can evaluate the people correctly. One of the things that's critical is that know that a mastermind group is a small group. Really great functioning masterminds only have about 4-5 people at the most. You can have a mastermind with just 2 people, but know that you'll be playing off your strengths and weaknesses off of each other. Making it into a triad of 3 is effective, but you can get lost in them against me. When you start having 4 to 6 people, you create a dynamic that really can become cohesive and really builds different subcategories and subgroups of strengths that help you grow. But before you do, that is really know the kind of people that you want there so that you don't just ask anyone. You become very, very focused. When selecting the person and people to be involved, you really want to look for a diversity of talents and perspectives. A mastermind group is strengthened by bringing people together with different outlooks. This allows members' gifts to complement and dovetail with each other, like building a house. Diverse materials being meshed together can build a very strong foundation. As we said in the beginning, too often we see ourselves in our weakest position and not our strengths, so we tend to bring in people who are at a different learning level, usually at a lower learning level. This makes us feel good, but it may not help us. In order for us to grow, we need to bring in people who strengthen us and propel us forward. We need to find people who are at two or three levels in other areas of our business and life. You will offer your strengths to them, and they will offer theirs to you. Also look not only at the diversity of their business and their levels of knowledge, but look at a diversity in terms of gender, ethnicity, some of their own religious backgrounds. The more you get a different perspective, the more you can create and find information that can propel you even faster forward. And isn't that what we all really want? Finding people who have different talents, different mindsets, and different strengths requires you to reach outside your comfort zone. By asking others, people in your neighborhood, people who work in different industries, by attending local chapter meetings different than your normal groups, by going within your own office building to a different table to sit and talk and introduce yourself, you begin to gather information and see how you fit with different people. You'll see how you can actually grow yourself by interacting with different kinds of people. What you want to do is reap names of people who would be interested in being part of a mastermind group. Don't rush into this. Don't go sharing to a bunch of friends and saying, let's do this on our own. This is for your growth. It's not for your friends' growth. This is for you to really achieve the results that you want in your life. So take the time to really learn and get to know different people. Don't just grab the first person you meet, because if you really want to succeed, you're going to need to share information and be open and honest about where you are. While people may be different than you, while they may have different perspectives than you, you still want to know that you can communicate with each other, you still want to know that you can trust each other, and you still want to know that you can truly be yourself. Be selective regarding the people you invite to join. You want to be selective because you'll be committing a valuable commodity to this process. That's your time. You cannot be distracted by people who will drain your time and your energy. By being selective, it's about taking ownership for the quality of your life. Remember the adage, you are who your friends are? Make sure that the group that you're designing is one that will propel you to the future and not hold you back. There are two key components that enter into this selection. It's your fear of rejection and your fear of success. Let's look at the fear of rejection. When we know that we have to find somebody who, or when we know somebody who has something that we want and that we really want them into our mastermind, we can avoid asking them because we're afraid if we do ask them, they won't want to come play with us. Cut that out. The reality is that if you truly want to succeed, you have to take the risk of rejection. You have to take the risk to put yourself out there and say, hey, I am putting together this group. I think that you would be a valuable asset. I know that I could provide you information that you need, and I'm interested in finding out if you're interested in being a part of this. And then don't just say that you are a part of it. All you're doing is opening up a dialogue to see if it's something that they're interested in and whether you'd be interested in having them. Slow down and take this process of selection seriously. Don't rush into something because of fear or because you're afraid that you're going to look like you're being too nosy. This is your life and only you can control what's occurring. The other thing that's going to happen is you're going to have people coming to you saying, I want to join, I want to join. Can I be a part of this? No, you have to stop that. Now, if they are somebody that you would like to be in part of this, if you think that there's someone that's going to bring you an asset, well, that's great. Slow down. Tell them that you'd like to be interested, that you're interested in talking to them about it, and let's have lunch or breakfast or coffee to get to know each other. Don't rush into this. This is your life. Remember, you want this mastermind to be so powerful, so energizing, so strong that it'll propel you to the success that you've been dreaming of. Take the time now to make sure the people that you're surrounding yourself with, that you'll be sharing with, can help you do that. Don't be afraid of hurting somebody's feelings and being honest with them. Hey, I appreciate the fact that you want to do the mastermind group with me. I know what I need, and right now I'm just searching and looking at different people. If I don't choose you, it's not because I don't like you. It's just that I'm looking to fulfill some certain needs in me. Why don't you go about fulfilling your own mastermind? Here's a CD. Why don't you order Pegine's CD and learn about how you can do it? Don't take ownership of other people's stuff. You only take ownership of your own stuff, and then that stuff that's holding you back, you let go. Remember with the mastermind that small is good. Four to six members is ideal. And don't work with whoever might show up. Remember, again, it goes back to thinking about your own growth strategically and about who might aid you in getting to where you want to be. Make sure that the people that you're working with are nurturing and that they look for supportive relationships. Beware that when you're looking and interviewing people to be part of your mastermind, that one or two meetings is really not enough. You need to have a couple of more so that you can really evaluate the person. Is this someone that you communicate with? If you've already picked a couple of other people to be involved, how would this person mesh with them? Where are their values? Where are their needs? What are their desires? And does that support the purpose, again, of the mastermind group? Take time and be selective. This is really for your good and for the good of the group that you're organizing. Remember, put the fear of rejection to the back burner. Acknowledge your fear of success, because that's when we're not asking for the people, when we stop ourselves from not asking the people who really should be part of the group, or if they can't make it, knows people that should be part of our group. Keep at bay your fears. Remember, fears are only false evidence appearing real. It's your own fears, your own mindset that's saying that they wouldn't, shouldn't, and couldn't. You don't know the answer to that because you can't read what's going on in their mind. You have to get through your fears, take the risk, and ask them to be involved. It's your life. It's time to go for it. When you're introducing the concept of the mastermind, and once you've found those people, those four to six people who are going to be part of the mastermind, you need to ensure that the potential members buy into the concept of a mastermind group. In other words, are they really clear what a mastermind group is and what they will get out of it if they're involved? Have they read Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich book? Have you? If you haven't read the book, I urge you to buy it. You can buy it through my website if you'd like, but you need to read that book and understand how you can be propelled to the next level. And let me tell you, the book doesn't just look at from a business and becoming rich. The concepts in the book can be covered in every part of your life. From your parenting skills to your spiritual desires. It helps you understand how your mind works and how your thoughts work for you to achieve the results that you want to have. So I highly recommend reading the Think and Grow Rich book. If the potential members aren't clear about what a mastermind group is and know the benefits and outcomes they will receive, you won't get the necessary buy-in needed for your group. Often people will say yes because they themselves are afraid of rejection, but they don't even know what they're getting into. You want to make sure that not only do they understand what they're getting into, but they actually believe it and want to create the momentum to achieve the results. One of the things that's important about this is even sitting down and having a discussion with the members, not as the first mastermind meeting, but as a chance for you all to get together and talk about what they feel a mastermind is for them, and see whether it's something that they are interested in learning more about, whether they need to learn anything more about it, or whether they can commit right then and there. Here are some questions that you really do want to ask yourself and the group, and you could ask them at dinner or when you're together for coffee. Is each member vested in the success of the group? Do they understand the impact that having several people together can actually make their minds work that much faster, that much harder, become more creative, be able to see opportunities that they never saw before? Do they truly understand what the success of the group can be? Can they articulate what they stand to gain? Do they know what they want? If they don't know what they want and they don't know what they hope to gain, they're not going to commit themselves to it. Make sure each member is very clear what they want to get out of this group. Do they have anything at stake, or are they committed to your good? Now, here you have sometimes you have people that want to be involved because they love you, because they want to be part of you, because they want to touch you, feel you, be with you, but it's not really because they have anything that they want to go after. Be aware that sometimes people say yes a lot of times, but they truly don't believe it. That's why I said before, take your time. Do this pre-work before you start your group. You want to know to what degree are the group's values and norms shared. How much and how committed are they to the group at large? Is this something that they've always wanted to do and they're thrilled because finally it's happening? Is it something that they've never heard of, but they're willing to give it a try? You know, but if something comes up better, they'll go for that too. Are these people trying groupies? You know, they bounce from place to place to place, and if the results aren't seen quickly, they just drop it. You really want to be clear about what their values and what their norms are regarding group and group involvement. You want to make sure you and the others are clear about the intention of the group, how often you'll meet, the expectations you and others have for the members. One of the things that's really important is defining how often you want to meet. You can do this before your meetings ever start so that you get a sense of where people's commitment is. Some people are just too busy and cannot make the commitment to show up when they say they're going to show up. Others are looking for a different kind of mastermind group, one that only meets once a quarter, which can be very effective if it's very planned out and clear about the expectations. You need to know that if you want a mastermind group that meets once a week, you better make sure that those people can meet once a week. If you have a group that can only meet once a month, be clear how long you can meet, how long you want to meet, and how those systems will be set up. There is nothing worse than having a four-person mastermind group and one person doesn't show up. It truly messes up your mastermind group. So, you need to ensure that the potential members buy into the concept of a mastermind group. This brings us to trust, because trust is a critical evaluator for your group. The mastermind is only valuable to the extent of trust amongst its members. Makes sense. Groups don't go far without high levels of trust. It's extremely important to have a high level of trust because you will be sharing information with your members. You'll be asking questions of them that, at times, may be embarrassing to you. You know what I mean. There's the person you put out there in public, the capable, knowledgeable, powerful person. But in the mastermind group, you need to have the freedom to share what you don't know. You need to be able to share yourself as not weak, but with a need for knowledge, a thirst for knowledge, that you know other people won't be evaluating you and saying, "Ugh, she doesn't know that." You really want to be able to say what's in your feeling or what you lack knowing so that the others in the group can share and give you the information that you need to succeed. This is not a group where you need to bring in the public persona out there. This is a place that you really want to bring your true self. Because if you're talking about business, there are so many things that you need to know. There are so many facets at each level that you want to know that if you can't honestly discuss this with someone else, then, you know, within your mastermind, then you really have a problem here. Because this group is about your personal growth, your growth as a professional, your growth as a person, and you need to have the trust to know that what you say there is going to stay there. How this occurs is that you begin to create trust as you go around interviewing people for the group. You see, they have to be willing to commit to being confidential and to confidentiality. That means they can't share the war stories with others. Ever. They can't share your story with others. Ever. It's not their place. It's not what they're supposed to do. And if they do it, aren't they breaking your trust? Of course, they can share the lessons they've learned for themselves, but they can't share others' stories. The members you seek need to be very clear about this, and they need to evaluate their commitment to it. Some people just love gossiping and talking about other people. Sometimes they don't even know that it's gossip. You can't do that in a mastermind. In a mastermind, what you see here, what you say here, stays here. If they can't abide by this, or if there's a problem, or brings a problem with it, you need to clarify that and clear it up right away. The worst thing that could happen in a mastermind group is trust is broken. And it needs to be reminded all the time. At every monthly meeting, every weekly meeting, whenever it is that you meet, this issue of confidentiality needs to be reminded. Hey, you know, we're humans. We have so much going through our head. Some of us go through so many meetings that we need to be reminded about the rules. And that's okay. It's okay to remind people of the rules so they play by the rules. Just remember that trust is a critical evaluator for your group. If there isn't any trust, there will not be any movement. Cooperation means joint operation or action. What are group members willing to work with each other on? Remember, cooperation is key to the success of your group. This includes the willingness of participants to listen to, then heed the advice of the group, or at least be willing to take the advice under consideration. Cooperation brings the element of support. This is especially true when introducing ideas and information. Cooperation in a mastermind group includes the process to set up meeting dates. You see, we're all busy, and there are times that we cannot meet at an agreed time, even if it's written in stone. Stuff happens. How you deal with the changes is critical to the cooperative spirit of meeting. In some of my mastermind groups, we set up a process. It went like this. Let's say I had to cancel a meeting. I would be responsible for communicating to all my mastermind partners my issue, find out some meeting dates, reschedule the meeting, communicate to everybody to ensure that they have the the right meeting date and make sure that everything and everyone was notified. Like, we used to meet in a restaurant, so I would have to call them up and let them know that we weren't coming that day. Now, if it happened more than twice in a specific period, I would have been asked to leave the group. You see, commitment is critical to the group process. Cooperation also means looking for information that would benefit the group. You know, like cutting out an article and sharing it with the group, or finding a resource that someone was looking for and then sending it along to them. You can strengthen the cooperative spirit within your mastermind group by meeting with members outside of your regularly scheduled mastermind meeting. In one mastermind group that I belong to, we decided to meet with a different member individually after the mastermind meeting. 1 month I was with Sally, the next with Bill. It really strengthened our relationship and increased the value we all received during our mastermind meetings. Another aspect of cooperation is you. Your willingness to acknowledge when your buttons are being pressed. When a member suggests something to you or points out an aspect of your behavior that's holding you back, stop and listen. If you find yourself getting defensive, angry, frustrated, you know, in other words, your buttons are being pressed, you have to be willing to be cooperative and be willing to acknowledge your emotions to the group while seeking to understand why you reacted so strongly to their suggestions. You see, the message created a strong response in you, and you need to be willing to look within yourself to understand why the response made you feel that way, and acknowledge that that may be what's been holding you back all along. Remember, cooperation is a joint operation. Your buttons will be pressed, and through your acknowledgement, you will grow. Harmony deepens when everyone is aligned 100% with the group's common purpose. The bonding of the group is what makes masterminding works. Out of this bonding, there forms a whole which is greater than the sum of the parts. The mastermind forms a deeper creativity than the individual talents of the members. Often, while the members are on the same page, personalities may get in the way of productivity. Personalities do play a role in the success of the group. That's why, when I was sharing before about going out with members one-on-one individually after a mastermind meeting is important, this is a way for you to create some of the bonding. Remember when we were talking earlier about looking for members? When you do look at them, look at different potential members and how they view life. Do they always see the problems, or do they give a balanced approach to solutions? Are they overly optimistic to the point that they don't see the danger signs up ahead? I mean, they are way too Pollyanna. How do they relate to each other? As the group forms, there's got to be a process, and they go through a very specific kind of process that has four components. The first is forming. This is in the beginning of the creation of the mastermind, when individuals are not clear about what their contribution is. It's the getting to know you phase, often called the dating phase. This is when you're just seeing who's who and how you really interact. Trust, at this point, may just be starting to be built. Storming is a second in the process of group formation. This is when trust is focused into smaller groups or subgroups, where alliances are creating. Harmony plays a critical role in this storming session. People need to know where they fit in with individuals within the group. Over time, depending on how often you meet, this storming group, you may see different groups meeting together, talking to each other, laughing at each other across the table, and creating a connection that is building small, trusting groups. However, if personalities clash, negative alliance may erupt. People may form into pairs against that negative influence. Norming is as roles are accepted and clarified. You'll find that as you go through a mastermind group or any group, that people will become leaders, people will become followers, some people will bring in information, some will just stay quiet. Trust in relationships starts to develop to a greater degree as people get to acknowledge who's who and what they do, and the commitment to the ultimate purpose of each person's success. So that if one person is always quiet, the group, during this norming process, will notice that and will take actions to make sure that that person is involved. It's when the group begins to focus on specific issues and begins the growth process, leading ultimately to what is called process. This is when the real benefits of the mastermind appear. The mastermind starts to operate on higher levels of trust as loyalty and relationships develop. Harmony is understanding this process of forming, storming, norming, and process. Harmony occurs as people then begin to create a powerful mastermind. But remember, it's critically important that we know the people who are coming into this group. Negativity can be or a negative person can be one of the biggest factors to the disruption of a mastermind. Make sure that the people are balanced, that they're not super enthusiastic or super negative. Either one of those extremes can affect how the mastermind functions and where the mastermind goes. When negativity creeps into mastermind or a mastermind group, everything begins to break away. The group must seek the positive aspects of its members. When complaints, absenteeism, or a breakdown in process occurs, the group must come back and make a decision, asking themselves what's causing this dissatisfaction. Being positive in regards to the benefits of the group are important to building trust again and having results. Being positive is critical for each member because it's only through the positive rewards and personalities that people will maintain membership in this self-enhancing process. When you're selecting people, one of the things that you really need to focus on is how do they present their complaints? How do they share what's bothering them when you ask them? How do they really verbalize where they're at in their business and where they want to be? Remember that it takes process and time, because one of the things that can happen is people want to look their best to you. So when you're going through this interviewing process, I mean, they may be, wow, excited and wonderful and all this stuff. But in reality, they're not that way. So it will take you getting to know them a little bit better to know, yes, this is someone that is really focused on where they want to go. They're willing to take the actions. They are in a positive frame of mind. And remember, sometimes you won't see that because if you're not there, you won't be able to see when someone else is either. Well, how does a mastermind group maintain its positive outlook? One way is to have each member at the end of every meeting identify one thing of value that they receive from the meeting. This is very important. If people don't acknowledge what they got out of the meeting, and if they didn't get anything out of the meeting, well, first, if they acknowledge the things that they did get out of the meeting, then everybody around the table sees value. If they didn't get any value out of the meeting, then it's time to evaluate what occurred in the meeting. Why didn't this person walk away with some sort of one piece of information or something that supported their growth? Another technique is to review what positive occurrences happened since the last meeting. If the result is because of a conversation, idea, or piece of advice that was offered during the last meeting, it's important to share that bit of information. Since you're one of the organizers of your own mastermind, it would be important for you to at least begin that process of sharing, "Hey, this happened. Thank you so much for sharing this information. This is what occurred in my life this week because of the mastermind." Well, maybe not because of the mastermind, but because of the information I received during the mastermind and the implementation of those ideas. By sharing positive feedback, the group becomes energized and refocused on the why they're there. Your success will depend on your responsibility to seek the positive value of your mastermind group. Just as it's critically important for your success in business to acknowledge the successes that you've had. Most people wait until the end of the year to review the successes that they've had in their lives. It's even more important to do it on a monthly basis, or if you're in a slump, on a weekly basis. Your mind can tend to skew and see negativity. We had to force ourselves to look at all the positive abundances that we have. This includes when you're working in a mastermind. You'll need to look at what did you get out of this. Remember, you're using a valuable commodity in your life, time. You need to show how this use of your time brings you benefits, not just some benefits, but great benefits. By focusing on the positive, you'll see benefits that you never imagined. Facilitation and its importance to a mastermind. I found that groups tend to stay on purpose or on task when there is someone watching over the group. Without the process or without a facilitator, the group can lose its purpose. In some instances, you could bring in an outside facilitator. I do that with a lot of different mastermind groups and create them here over the phone or where I go to a place and I facilitate it. Or you, as the founder of your mastermind, can begin the process by being the facilitator. You really learn to facilitate by doing it. You can make it so that the facilitator changes every meeting. But the role of the facilitator is always the same, to have the group stay on track. The facilitator watches the time and ensures that each participant has had an opportunity to participate. The facilitator is only there to ensure that the meeting stays on track, ends on the agreed time, and that a future date is planned. The facilitator can also be there. Well, this is really if it's an outside facilitator, to help the dialogue move forward, to show how where you've come and where you're going, and to keep the process alive. If you're doing it on your own, one of the things that you need to do is make sure that you understand the process that you're going to be implementing for your meeting. In the next track, I'll be sharing what some processes are. Well, and also, the other piece about being a facilitator is understanding that when you are doing it as part of your mastermind group, you are only in that role at that moment. Each person should really have the opportunity to facilitate the mastermind meeting. Sometimes, and in some groups, they have the process written very specifically so that the facilitator reads the opening, follows through on everything that the group has agreed will happen at each meeting, and make sure that the ending or close is also communicated. This is a good way for each person to take an active role and for people to get to know you. Masterminds are powerful, and they become even more powerful when there is a facilitator involved, whether it be a member of the group or you bring someone from the outside. We talked a little bit about the process of the mastermind meeting. Let's go a little bit into depth about that. Having a defined process that is flexible is important for any mastermind. There are a variety of ways to run a mastermind meeting, but by determining the purpose of the meeting, you can then create the process. In other words, we start where we started. Many masterminds start with a prayer or a significant quote that is relevant to the group. Obviously, if it's a diverse group and it's a business group, you wouldn't start with a prayer. But you can create, or everybody can bring in a quote so that people get focused about why they're there. Some masterminds create a mission statement and a vision that is read at each meeting, at each opening of the meeting. The purpose of this opening is to create a clear beginning and refocus everyone on why they're part of the group. Often, mastermind meetings include a review of where they've been, a celebration of sorts for the accomplishments that have occurred. Each person shares what's occurred, their news, and then the group goes around introducing their issue. Let me repeat that. First, there's an opening. Then there's a review of where they've been. People share their accomplishments, and you have a mini celebration. And once everyone has shared their news, then the group goes around again introducing their specific issues, while the others offer insights, resources, or support. It's critical that during this experience, the facilitator maintains the time. You know how it is. It can easily get out of hand and become unfocused. All somebody has to do is say, I did blah, 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 and somebody jumped in, oh my gosh, that happened to me, and blah, 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 and they start talking, and everybody gets involved, and suddenly, before you know it, 15 minutes has passed by, and nothing was resolved. A facilitator is there, again, either someone from the outside or within your group, who's saying, time, that's it. Some groups take a moment or two of silence after hearing what the issue is from a specific person. They get quiet so that they can seek answers from within and be able to then share that information. You know, this process works really well because rather than just jumping in with ideas, the group takes a moment to regroup individually and truly ponder and seek responses rather than jumping and saying the first thing that pops in their head. It is always very powerful. Remember just before when I said that somebody will say something and then others will jump right in with, oh, this happened to me and that happened to me and you know how this goes and oh my God, blah, 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 blah. When you make include in your process those 2 or 3 seconds for everybody to just close their eyes or write and refocus about that particular issue, what comes out of that is powerful, powerful results. Rather than just idle chatter or empathy, what really comes to be is what is solutions, which is the whole point of being a mastermind group. After this has gone through, each person then states what they'll do before the next meeting. What is their goal? What do they want to achieve? What advice are they going to take and then implement? They share that to everyone, and everyone then writes that down. So that I would take Bill's and Sue's information and write that down on my paper. That way, before our next meeting, if I happen to talk to Bill or if I happen to talk to Sue, I could support them by asking them, how are they doing on their goal that they stated? I haven't written in my book. They have mine written in theirs. We become a cooperative, very focused on supporting each other's goals. We end the meeting with either the quote or another quote, and then we go on our merry ways. The process is repeated at each mastermind. You formulate your own process. There are several resources out there on masterminding, and you'll be able to look forward to a time when I have my own mastermind journal that I can share with you. If you would like more information, please let me know. So here you have it, the tips and the way to reach a successful mastermind alliance by following the 11 concepts that I shared. Just to review, they are: determine the purpose of the group, know that you will need to enroll other people in your vision of success, look for a diversity of talents and perspectives, be selective regarding the people you invite to join. Ensure that potential members buy into the concept of a mastermind. Remember that trust is a critical evaluator for your group. Cooperation is key to the success of your group. Harmony will make your life much happier. Be critical. Make sure that people have a positive attitude before they walk in that door. Know that you might be a facilitator or bring one in. And understand what's going to happen at your first, second, and third mastermind meeting by following the process of the mastermind. Mastermind groups propel you to the unexpected levels of success. We here at Team Pegine can facilitate your group, or you can join one of the new groups that are being formed. We have groups by phone and in person, and you can contact us at pegine.com. Whatever you do, start a mastermind now. Go through the process and create a group of supportive, incredible, powerful people who will propel you to the future that you so deserve. I really, truly look forward to hearing about your new mastermind groups and learning about your successes. May you be given prosperity, good health, and love in the coming months. This is Pegine from Team Pegine, your all-access pass to your potential.
For more products and information about Pegine and Team Pegine, please go to www.pegine.com. That's www.pegine.com, or call 904-280-8806. That's 904-280-8806.